Morning. It's so good to be here in person with you this morning. And to those of you online, welcome. Will you stand and worship our graciously forgiving Father this morning?
Ocean. wings rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Oh, oh, oh. Your grace abounds in deepest waters, your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you never fail, and you won't start now. And
the good times, the joyous times, even the unknown, know that God wants you to come home and rest in His embrace. Call upon Him this morning. May He make you brave. May your faith be made stronger in the presence of our Savior. Sing this with me. This morning, to trust without borders, to reach farther than your feet have taken you before. May not always be easy, especially for me. I don't know about you, but it's what we're called to do as children of God. All right, it's time now for Sunday school. So those who are interested in going, you can head back to the back of the church. And while they do that, will you please let us know that you're here today. Some of you have already done it, but take the attendance pads and pass them down the row. And then for those of you online, feel free to fill out a Connect card this morning. We love to connect with you, and we're so glad that each and every one of you is here this morning. Will you continue with us as we sing of His beautiful name?
Glory in creation now revealed.
powerful name it is. You have no rival. You have no equal, God. Your name is the most powerful. Thank you for being our Father in heaven and calling each one of us children of God. For embracing us in the good times and the bad. Even though our sins are great, your love was and is and always will be greater. Thank you. May we have the courage to extend past our comfort zones, God, and place all of our trust in you and not worry as we extend our hands to our neighbors near and far. May we share the good news of your redeeming grace, even to those who it may not always come easy, God. May we love as you love, serve how you serve, because it is by you that we are alive, God. I pray this morning for each and every soul that's participating in this service, in person or online, right now or later in the week. I pray that they are filled with your presence and they know you are near. May this service fill their cups so they can spread your love more freely to others. We feel you here today, God. Continue to be present with us. Open our eyes to see and our ears to hear. Be with Pastor Sondra as she delivers the message that you've laid on her heart. I pray this all in your name. Amen. You may be seated. Our scripture this morning is from Romans 10, chapters 12, verses 12 through 15. For there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can anyone preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. It's our scripture for today.
Good morning, everyone. Oh, we're in trouble if I'm tongue-tied already, right? It's great to be with you in worship this morning. My thanks to those who've helped lead us. Beautiful music this morning. Hopefully, all of you are sensing God's presence with you. We began last week, and we'll be talking the next few weeks about the I and why. The church's mission is the why. Why do we come together? Why do we do what we do? It's because of the great good news of Christ Jesus, who has come to transform, redeem all people. And each person, you, all people, have a place in that good news, in God's design, God's desire for all people. The vision of a church then is, well, how do we do that? How do we help all people come to know the love of Christ? And last week, we talked the C of crew, being part of the crew at Mentor UMC, a way for us to kind of think in a new way, perhaps, was connect. The most important relationship that you can have is a connection with Jesus. And that's what we're about. It's about us helping you, helping all live into a Christ-centered life, a life we believe that leads to life abundant and full and eternal. And we want to help you with that connection. And we also then connect with each other. We live out this good news of Christ in our lives in relationship, in community with others. So it's important that we connect with others. But I kind of been thinking, well, who are the others? Obviously, we kind of look around this room, or we think about who's connecting online. We just encounter others within a church community. But this morning, for a few moments, I'd like us to just consider, who are the others? If we're supposed to connect with others, and that's how we live out this relationship that Jesus has with us in community, who are the others? Just like any family, the community of faith, we inherit some folks. When you connect with a community of faith, there are other people there, and you didn't always choose who else was part of the family. There are just some that are already present. And each person, just like in a family lineage, each person is important to the storyline. If we look at Matthew's beginning, the Gospel of Matthew, we see Jesus' lineage. Matthew lays out for generations Jesus' lineage. And if you look over that list and engage in biblical study, there are some real characters on that list. Some folks who did some things that you would think, gosh, I can't believe they are a part of the Messiah's lineage. Yet each person, if you were to remove one of those people on that lineage, it would change the chain. Every life is important. And so even in the community of faith, we strive to learn and incorporate each person, because we come in many churches. I've heard that folks might attend and see who else is there and say, well, I'm not going there. I don't like that person. And yet we've missed out on the good news of Christ at work, that maybe that's exactly the relationship to work through, to discover the power of God and what God is doing as God's story unfolds and God's love and transformation. So when we unite with a community of faith, we inherit some folks. But then the family grows, because other people are grafted in, adopted, become part of the family tree, so to speak. Families grow. I mean, I never heard of a Snode before I met Tom. The Snode family didn't know what hit them. They still may not know what hit them 35 years later. I made an imprint on the Snode clan because of my presence. You know, before I arrived, I'm not sure Tom understood the importance of birthday celebrations. I mean, birthday celebrations are important. It is meant for more than one day. It is meant for at least a week and maybe the whole month. And he is well aware now that August has arrived. You know, when we grew our family then, and then our daughter-in-law became grafted in. Not sure she knew what a Snode was before she met Eli. I did not know the significance of deviled eggs at Easter until Catherine became a part of our clan, our story. So our family grows in little ways and in big ways, but each person begins to shape that kingdom, that clan. The community of faith is full of others. And each story impacts the makeup of God's kingdom. It's God's desire that all others become a part. And so in our day-to-day and in our relationships with each other, we begin to see the impact that others have upon us. Some folks just show up and become part of a vital, important kingdom work. You are an important part of that storyline, of that picture of the kingdom, but so are others. Who are the others? Jesus was always welcoming and incorporating others. Here's just a few examples that come to my mind. You may have others. Come to me, all You who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Jesus doesn't just point to a small group. He says, come to me, all of you who are burdened. This is quite an extraordinary invitation, isn't it? That we don't have to come when we have it all together. We can't just become part of a family or a church community, the body of Christ at work in the world. When we have our acts together, then we can kind of step into that. No, Jesus says, come to me if you are weary and broken and beat down, all, and I will give you rest. Jesus said, let the little children come to me. So this is an invitation that you don't have to have everything straight. You don't have to have all the knowledge. You don't have to have numerous PhDs in biblical scholarship, ecclesiology, and all the ologies I won't go into. Jesus said, come to me. Let the little children come with an eagerness to know, with an eagerness to be open to what is to be instructed, to set aside yourself, to not just have to have it all together, for such is the kingdom of God. Zacchaeus, you come down. I'm going to your house today. Pastor Michaela explored this passage a few weeks ago. Zacchaeus was one of the outcasts. Zacchaeus was a hated tax collector. He had swindled people. He was not thought highly of in the community. He was marginalized and disliked. And yet Jesus said, Zacchaeus, come on. I'm going to your house today. Jesus invites himself into your stuff. I'm reminded of the woman who showed up and anointed Jesus' head with expensive perfume. And the disciples were like, gosh, what is this woman doing? She's wasting precious resources. Culturally, she had no reason to be there. She was poor. She was viewed culturally in a way that made her an outsider. And yet Jesus said, hold on a minute. For generations to come, this woman will be remembered. Jesus kept expanding the circle, kept inviting others to come. It didn't matter their background, it didn't matter their history, that didn't matter whose family lineage they were a part of. Jesus invited and welcomed the other to come to know his transforming love. And when he left this earth, he left the instructions to his disciples to go into the world and baptize all nations, all the others. In other words, just fling out the power of baptismal water, which signifies the grace of God, bringing redemption and freedom to all. Jesus defines the other as all. I remember learning in a class in seminary that the church must always think about who is not present. And that when churches get off track, it's that they become so focused on who is internally that we lose track of who's not present. And as my years of ministry have unfolded, sometimes I've learned the difficulty of this, but also, you know, the scales keep falling off, that it's like, but we have to keep reaching out and helping others come to know the love of Christ. So an essential key to the mission of the church, the vision to help all come to know Christ's love, is that we must keep expanding the circle, and thus we must reach out. Reach is to extend beyond our comfort zones, beyond our family lineage to include others, to go as far as, to stretch. Everyone just stretch for a minute. That'll wake you up. All right. we stretch. It kind of pushes us beyond what we might define or is comfortable for us. And this is the call to evangelism, a call to expand Christ's message into the world. And some people, you might have even broke out into a hive when you heard the word evangelism. But evangelism is simply sharing the gospel, sharing the good news of Christ. And so if you know Jesus, then you have a story to tell. You have a story to tell. And how are you qualified for this task? You might be like, well, I don't have any qualifications. And even Paul, in a way, is writing to preachers, but I'm expanding that to have us all live into that role this morning. It's that if you know Jesus, then you can do it. You can reach, you can stretch. As easily as you just stretched this morning, you can stretch out and help someone else know the love of God. The scriptures continue to teach and instruct us on helping others come to know the good news of Christ. The challenge of it, Jesus models for us servant leadership, forgiveness, not once, but 70 times seven. I mean, these stretch us, but part of the role of discipleship is to help us engage in that journey. Who are the others? The Apostle Paul came to understand other in a new way. He was a Jew, a Pharisee among all Pharisees. And Philippians 3, this is how Paul describes himself. If someone else thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews. In regard to the law, a Pharisee. As for zeal, persecuting the church. As for righteousness based on the law, faultless. See, Paul, he was top notch, Pharisee. But he goes on and he says, but whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. The scales fell from Saul's eyes, literally. And he was transformed because his limited understanding of what God was doing in the world was broadened, was redefined when he encountered Jesus. There were no longer outsiders in Paul's definition or in the world because all became a part of God's plan of salvation. Paul's letter to the Romans is his attempt to help the early church come to understand the key elements of faith. Rome was a great city, a city in the greatest empire of the world. Yet in that city of knowledgeable people, of power, they still needed to come to understand the core elements of faith in Christ. Paul had not founded the church in Rome, and in fact, when he wrote this letter that we know, he was in Corinth and had never even been to Rome. So he wrote them because many people assumed a lot about him. They knew that, well, isn't this the guy who was killing Christians and now we're supposed to listen to him? Who's he get off, you know, telling us what to do when he's never even been here? He's not part of our history. So Paul writes this very theological letter. To study Romans is deep understanding of who God is. But Paul wanted the early Christians to have this core essential understandings of who Jesus was in their lives and Jesus' call upon them to expand the circle. Paul lays out the essence of faith and belief. And in our passage this morning that Kara shared with us, Paul encourages believers to claim their rightful place in God's kingdom, to live into the truth that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. an encouragement to preachers, but to all people. It's the use of these questions, a rhetorical device. So if you kind of like think about, you know, like, well, if you are to all who call on the name of the Lord to be saved, well, you can't do that unless you've heard the message, and you can't hear the message unless someone shared the message with you, and they can't share the message with you unless they know the message, and they wouldn't share the message with you unless they'd been sent to tell you. So it's kind of like this sequence of things. Paul's trying to help others see or hear what seems obvious to him to now. Others who don't know Christ rely upon those who do know Christ to tell them and to show them the difference that Christ makes. Paul had become one, an evangelist, a preacher, one who went into the world. He went to the Gentiles because the Jews that he was a part of wouldn't listen. He just expanded out into the world. Paul reminds all of us that we are a part of that lineage. We have a story to tell to the nations. If you know Jesus, you have a story to tell. It doesn't need to be eloquent. You don't have to have it all theologically arranged. But if Jesus gives you hope or encouragement, that if you've felt forgiven in your life, if you've received peace when in the midst of turmoil, you can just share that story with someone. Who are the others? We are the others. And the world is full of others. In reality, all of us are others. I am another. At my church of birth, I just showed up one day, this little bundle. And people spoke into me their story of Jesus. I showed up at Mentor United Methodist Church a couple years ago, stranger. You've spoken into me your stories, especially in a pandemic, especially even today, August 2021, where we're still dealing with the pandemic. Those among you who continue to watch for Jesus, who try to be peace-centered, who put the needs of others ahead of your own, this is us living out the gospel message, and this is our testimony to others. And the world who are anxious and uncertain, they look to us who know Jesus to share with them the love of Christ, trusting in the power of God. This past week, Mentor United Methodist Church lost three saints, all women, who had come into this fellowship, some of them decades ago. They were nurtured in Jesus, and they found a way to share their stories by answering the phone in the office, by teaching the children in our education wing. They found ways to care for others, to nurture their faith. And our church's history, our lineage is different because of all three of those women. Someone's life is different because they sought to grow in Christ. We don't pick and choose or vote on who Christ loves. And this is a key to our faith. This is the good news. Jesus invites all who call in the name of the Lord will be saved. You and me. And then we are sent into the world to share the story. I came across this reading in one of the devotions I'm using this year. Jill Brosco includes this little poem, and she doesn't cite anyone else. I think I've heard it before, but maybe it's hers. I dreamt death came the other night, and heaven's gates swung wide. An angel with a halo bright ushered me inside. And there to my astonishment stood folks I judged and labeled as quite unfit, of little worth, and spiritually disabled. Indignant words rose to my lips, but never were set free, for every face showed stunned surprise, for no one expected me. Who are the others? Who are the others? We are all others. And the redemptive act of Christ that occurred in the past continues to be real in the present because of God's transforming work, but in the telling and retelling and of what Jesus has done in our lives. We must be those who share the redemption story with others. Recently, I cleaned out our kitchen drawer, and I discovered a couple keys in there that I don't know what they're for. And I showed them to Tom. I'm like, do you know what these keys are for? And he's like, I don't know what those keys are for. It's still a key, right? But it had lost its importance because I forgot its purpose. We have keys, the essence of the faith, that are ours. But if we forget to use them, if we don't live into the purpose that is before them, then something is lost. Something is not unlocked. At Mentor Church, we're seeking to live into our vision to reach, to extend the love of Christ. So to be part of the crew is to reach out with the love of Christ to others, because a growing church reflects new lives being transformed by Jesus. And thus we build new relationships with other people. This is a key that Paul extends out to us today. But that we must be those who take that key and help others come to know the key of their life is Jesus. Your feet can be beautiful, Paul ends. Maybe not physically, but spiritually, your feet can take you to spread the good news of Christ. How beautiful are the feet of those willing to go and tell about Jesus. Who are the others? I am one of them. So are you. The world is full of others waiting to hear the difference Jesus can make in their lives. Won't you be one to incorporate them into the lineage, into the kingdom? May it be so. I invite our band to come back and prepare for our final hymn. Will you pray with me? Lord, we thank you for the love that you extend to us. I pray that each of us this day, gathered and tuned in, worshiping with us online, will open their lives to your love and your transformation. Incorporate us, Lord. Help us hear your invitation extended to us. And then I pray that we would each take the key that has unlocked our life with you, our connection, and extend this love to others through a kind act, through a forgiving word, a word of encouragement. Help us, Lord, to reflect your power and your grace at work. This is the church that you call us to be. Help us to reach out, extend ourselves, to stretch beyond our comfort zones, to realize our family is lacking until all have been incorporated in. Empower us, Lord, by your love and grace, to be who you call us to be. In Christ we pray. Amen.
What a powerful message. Will you stand as we prepare to go out into the week and tell our stories of the goodness of God in our lives.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow.
So may you go forth this week following Jesus, who wants to help all know their place in the family. And what if we just approached all the people that we met as someone in the family we just need to get to know and make sure they come to know Jesus in their lives. So be encouraged. Go forth in the good news and the strength of Jesus this day and every day. Amen.